Hi, welcome to Green TV, the show dedicated to positive green New Deal solutions and the independent green and Green Party candidates that advocate for them. I'm your host, Gail Farrell Parker. The independent Greens of Virginia advocate for jobs, lots of jobs, eco jobs for the economy, solar jobs, wind jobs, geothermal jobs, rail jobs, conservation and weatherization jobs. In fact, did you know that more Virginians, about 11,000, more Virginians work in solar jobs than in coal? And today we have with us by phone Matt Funichello, Green Party candidate from New York, to talk with us about his positive solutions for New York. Welcome, Matt.
Well, thank you very much, Gail. I appreciate the opportunity always to spread the good word.
Great. Matt, I have in the studio audience with us today, Pat LaMarche.
Hey, Matt.
Which is wonderful, a celebrity from the green recent past and certainly very currently active as well.
Yeah, it's wonderful to meet you as well, Matt. We're excited about your campaign.
Well, I am too. It's actually been incredibly heartening. We have spent about 6 months campaigning with as many green campaigns without very much money. It's all grassroots donations. Like many of the Greens who do run in more urban centers, I own a business. I know we have lawyers and doctors who run as well, and they tend to be a little bit more visible than the activists who run. But in our district, which is the entire Adirondack Park in upstate New York, it's 17,000 square miles. It is the single, I think it is the single largest congressional district east of the Mississippi. We have a huge amount of money spent every year by the corporate parties. So we are looking to instead, establish a grassroots hold here amongst voters of many different enrollments, and we seem to have done so. The media is paying amazing attention to the race and giving us lots of attention, and it's very substantive. It's not all spoiler methodology, and that's so refreshing to see, but to be the actual candidate in the middle of it is also very, very inspiring, too.
Thank you for that, Matt. You answered the question before I even asked it. That's great. We would like for you and for our viewers to know that the Independent Green Party of Virginia has a full slate of endorsee nominees for 2014. Gail Farrell Parker, yours truly, is on the ballot for the 1st Congressional District. John W. Smith in the 2nd. Justin Sedin in the 3rd. Colonel Albert Burkhart in the 4th, Dr. Ken Hildebrandt in the 5th, Elaine Hildebrandt, his wife, in the 6th.
They must live on a town line.
Yeah, they worked it out.
Yeah.
Tariq Salahi is in the 7th, Gary Blay in the 8th, William Carr, an independent, is in the 9th, Diane Blay, which is Gary's mother, is on the ballot in the 10th, and Dr. Joe Galdo in the 11th. He's a Green Party candidate. Janet Murphy is our candidate for U.S. Senate. Matt Funichello, the Ballot Access News reports that 27 states have independent Green and Green Party statewide candidates, and that New York also has a full slate of Green Party candidates. Matt, please tell us about the New York Green Party governor candidate, Howie Hawkins.
Well, Howie is a very good friend, and I did meet him not only through labor religion coalitions, but from meetings with the State Green Party as well. We both served on the state committee together a number of years back, and Howie is the reason why we are on the ballot in New York State at this point in time. He runs a tireless campaign each time around for whatever office he runs for. And 4 years ago when he ran for governor, he got us the commensurate number of votes. You need 50,000 votes in the gubernatorial election alone in New York State. That's how it works to get your party on the ballot line. And it had been a while since we'd had a ballot line, which is, of course, of tremendous use if you'd like to not collect signatures and be knocked off the ballot, as many Greens in other states have found to be the case. So huge applause and praise goes out to Howie for his work. He has a great grassroots setup in Syracuse. He's working on behalf of the poor, both working and non-working in the Syracuse area. He helps with housing for the economically disadvantaged. He is a Teamster. He works at UPS. That's his day job. And, you know, he's just a remarkable human being, very tireless. So we love the guy, and he's incredibly articulate. When he goes out and speaks to people, they really are going to get a good lesson. Nine times out of ten, no matter how astute they are, about an issue and probably a perspective they have never heard of before.
Some people say that Howie could be the next governor of New York with good polling numbers.
Yeah. Well, there's no one I would rather see be governor of New York who's currently looking for the job. It does seem that with a governor in place right now who is unafraid, you know, to use the New York City machine at his disposal on a regular basis, that we are even going to see the challenges that have been mounted from within his own party, you know, met fairly or ethically. We at the moment are just concerned as Greens about the lack of media coverage of the gubernatorial race from a Green perspective. They are really shutting Howie out of the election cycle. It seems easier for them to give me some or all of that media attention. And that's very unfortunate because the governor's race is much more important to us, honestly.
And that's why Green TV is so important. And it's available on pegmedia.org. for download. By the way, Matt, one of Howie's favorite statistics is that creating high-speed rail would create 4.9 million jobs. Matt, we have a graphic to help us with the next question, so I will read some of it to you for your benefit.
Sure.
The Independent Greens advocate rail to save lives and create jobs. They advocate for expanded rail cars on Metro Rail, dedicated new passenger rail tunnel under the Potomac River, high-speed rail in the existing right-of-ways along the interstate corridors, dedicated passenger rail track for Virginia Railway Express, electronic VRE signs, new tracks, more trains more often. Matt Funicello, what rail do you want to build in New York?
Well, essentially in upstate New York, which is the district I would be covering, and I mean, it really is upstate. It's all the way up 35 miles north of Albany, New York, that the district begins. So it really is right into the Adirondack Park and just the southern tip of it. It's very remote and it's fairly rural, and much of it is wilderness area. So it's not very populated. There are three major population centers that are not particularly well joined by rail. And many proponents from all political parties are in agreement that there should be money spent on building a better rail system. My own feeling is we have a huge public transportation issue here. Many of the people who live in the park all year round depend on the service economy. And what we lack, actually, is a combination of both rail and buses and bicycle paths and things of that nature that are not only tourism-friendly, but that also would aid people who are service workers or work in the food business or the tourist business like myself to get back and forth to work and to each other's homes and businesses. And that is also a huge job creator, but there's cargo as well. We have, at the moment, a major issue with oil trains coming from the Bakken area and also from the Alberta tar sands that are bringing in this crude oil that is incredibly rich in methane and very flammable and combustible. And they're running train cars right down through the middle of the Adirondacks, through all these little tiny towns and hamlets, on rails that are unsafe and incredibly outdated, and in train cars that have been banned almost everywhere else in the world, especially in Canada where they're made. So we're trying to get some action on this, and of course the corporate party candidates are not in any way looking to do that. They're looking to talk about transition, that's a favorite word of theirs, rather than making sure that whatever we do before we are in the era of photovoltaics and hydropower and sustainable energy and wind power, that instead we continue to milk the earth of this last resource. And if we have a 50-car derailment and a fire that burns and pollutes oil and water, water sources for decades to come, that's an acceptable loss from their perspective, not from ours.
Howie, as a Teamster, the Teamsters have really stood up against those train cars that are, as you said, outdated, often with not enough people on them. It was the Teamsters who stood up after that horrible tragedy in Canada, which I don't think could be that far from you or your district.
No, it took place in southern Quebec, and the exact name, I think it's Megantic.
Yes, yes.
Where that occurred, and 43 or 47 people actually were killed. Uh-huh. A large number of people were also injured or wounded, and the fires burned for days. The pollution cleanup is probably not even something we want to take a look at yet. Mm. The numbers are not out there. But again, you're talking about water sources that are not going to be clean for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, and I was really proud that the Teamsters stood up. I mean, it was such a difficult thing because they were talking about an issue that, you know, folks had just died. And yet they were saying, you know, we've been at the front of rail safety. It's time to really start listening.
Right.
Well, and of course, in this day and age, I was just listening to public radio on my way back from running an errand for my business. And while I was listening, they were talking about how the current public service union employees are not backing our incumbent governor in his race. The problem, of course, is that the unions at the administrative level are. They're fully endorsing, you know, these candidates who are of the corporate parties. And I find it wonderful that we are starting to branch off from them, which is difficult to do in New York because we have fusion voting.
Yes,
so for many, many years, there have been all of these what I like to call fake third parties that really are just underlings of the major corporate parties, and they funnel all of the resource, human and financial, they can grab from the successful building of the Green Party or the Libertarian Party, et cetera. And I think we're finally now gaining ground. It's been a long, long battle, but the disgust that the average voter has in New York State, in upstate anyway, is tangible. And definitely we're seeing the result of that in the campaign so far.
Did Howie get his 50,000 votes without being fusion, without a fusion candidacy?
Well, the New York State Green Party does not allow for cross-endorsement, specifically so that we do not work with these other parties at all.
That's impressive.
And it's hard to do that because most of the major parties do exactly that. They accept cross endorsements. It's quite common to have a corporate candidate running on two or three or four different ballot lines at once. The vote total stands, and then each party is given its ballot line based on whether they broke the 50,000 or not.
Right.
There's one party in particular in New York State that actually was brought in to defeat the possibility of a true labor party. Back in the 70s, and that party still exists, and it still has a couple very vocal members, and it is funded by George Soros, primarily. It has never endorsed anybody but Democratic candidates. So, I mean, the reality is we are always looking to say, why can we on the state level not find some way to partner with the people who belong to these other parties, because they are progressive in their intent. It's just the strategy they're employing of working under that tent does not seem to work at all.
You're tuned in to Green TV with Gail Farrell Parker and Pat LaMarche. We're interviewing Matt Funichello, New York's Green Party candidate for Congress. We'd like to we'd like to talk about how rail saves lives and some of the benefits of rail. Rail's a million times safer than auto travel. Rail pays for itself through economic growth. Every dollar invested in rail creates $20 in economic benefit. Rail enhances our national security. It makes us safer and more secure. In this area, it allows for rapid evacuation in an emergency, which is a very keen issue. Rail saves tax dollars, rail makes money, rail makes sense. Rail everywhere in America benefits all of America. Matt Funichello, what is the most important positive eco-job solution for the economy in your view?
Well, Well, actually, you have already asked the question, and I've already sort of answered it, that I would have answered that with. And it is public transportation and renewable transportation within the park. And by that, again, what I'm talking about with that is a public jobs program that would entail us rebuilding our rail systems within the Adirondack Park. And also looking at a much more successful public transportation system within the park. What we are actually experiencing at the moment is quite a bit of federal money coming in for highways. Our highways have been given a D constantly by the New York State engineers that work out of New York City and are basically hired by the state to decide what needs to be fixed and what does not. And on a general level, most of that money seems to be spent on very targeted and systemic fixes that don't actually alleviate traffic concerns or safety. I am a cyclist and would love to see bike trails enhanced throughout the Adirondack Park. Cycle tourism is huge in the Adirondacks, and yet we can't even fix the asphalt and paved surfaces within the park on some of the highways, never mind talk about the reality of widening them so that we can have safe shoulders for cyclists to travel. There are a number of rail-to-trail, I think there are three major rail-to-trail projects that have been suggested for the park on railways that are no longer used and that really couldn't be fixed, that would have to be rerouted. And there is, as is always the case, there is major discussion, and often it is us who prevent it from happening. As environmentalists, quite frequently, we would like to see those railways go back to being wilderness, which is what the Adirondack Park is supposed to be, rather than being rails or bike trails. But I'm kind of a blue dog, I guess, on that level, and I would like to see them turned into bike trails rather than rusty old railways. But one of the more successful stories about rail I have is a microcosmic story about the bakery that we run. And we are buying wheat from Watertown, New York, and a lot of people don't even realize that wheat is grown in New York State. But there's a 5,000-acre farm in Watertown, which is on the far west of the district. And at the moment, we actually are bringing wheat into a rail stop where there is a distributor. He actually built a spur so that he could bring the wheat in. And we are getting carloads of wheat in from less than 400 miles away. It's very fresh. It's freshly milled. And we're able to use it within a few weeks of harvest. It's really quite exciting. And we've gone from using a couple thousand pounds of that flour a year to using almost 300,000 pounds of that flour a year. So the growth of regional agriculture as a result of improved rails, it's another economic boon that is not talked about frequently enough.
It certainly seems that it's a fun thing about green candidates is that they have such green practices, and that's really exciting. Yeah,
yes,
that's really exciting.
I always like to say that the whole purity argument kills us always in the green movement. I like to say that as Americans, we need to learn to embrace the hypocrisy. I mean, we're born in the empire. As babies, we have already done insurmountable harm, just unconsciously. And as we become conscious of it, it's our duty to change our own practices and to try to change the practices of those around us. But we have to understand we're never going to be perfect, and we can't beat each other up over it either.
Exactly. And when I was running for vice president, a woman came up to me and said, I don't know if you really should be calling yourself the Green Party. I think you should just be the Practical Party. Let's be practical here.
That's a good point.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or the Common Sense Party, or any of the other wonderful names I've heard ascribed from people who are being positive.
Right, exactly. Yeah, people who still respect common sense.
Yes, exactly. I've heard names that involve expletives, too, usually from Democrats who are not happy with us, but I don't like those names much at all.
Yeah.
For the benefit of our viewers, Pat LaMarche has also written a book, Daddy, What is the Middle Class? And Pat, could you tell us where this is available?
Well, if you want it available at your local bookstore, you can get a hold of me.
I see.
My email is patlamarche@hotmail.com. I'm also traveling the country speaking about the book, so we could set something up like that. But it is available at the big bad guys on the internet.
I see.
The A word. Amazon, of course, you can get it there. And there are other fulfillment companies that have contacted us that have a greener way of looking at things. So we're trying to see about getting the book available through that as well.
I see. Yeah. Wonderful.
Well, and if you ever travel to our neck of the woods, Pat, we love to have people who have written books that are maybe a little bit off the beaten path. For those who are corporate consumers, we specialize in having book signings and readings from people of that ilk. We would love to be your hosts at any point in time, so we should get in touch after the show.
Yeah, let's do that. I'd love to do that, too. And this new book of mine, it's a history book about the middle class, and it's something we all need to know. We didn't learn it in high school, that's for sure.
It's kind of like the labor movement. When I was about 15 or 16 years old, I started to read about the labor movement in some kind of erstwhile fashion, feeling like I had not been taught much of anything about it by anyone other than my father, who was part of it.
Yeah.
And, I realized after reading a number of books, of course Howard Zinn's included, but a book by the IUE, which was called The Labor's Untold Story, which should be required reading in every single schoolroom across the country. Most people don't even know it exists. It tells the history of the people who basically said, we are not going to be wage slaves for the foreseeable future. We're going to fight. We're going to fight for a standard of living that is just. And it's really what we're doing right now. It's really why I'm running this campaign, is that I think organized labor has failed the American worker. And as a small businessman and as a bread baker, I am of the working class. I'm not in the disappeared middle class, and I'm not deluded enough to think that my slightly more expensive truck makes me a different class of people than the people I bake bread with at 3 o'clock in the morning. We're the same people, and we make the same money, and we all don't have health insurance. These are things that need to be rectified, and running for dog catcher or supervisor or school board is not going to get me single-payer health care. It's not going to get me $15 an hour as a livable wage, and it's not going to end corporate welfare. We need to elect people to Congress who already advocate these things. Adding a couple more millionaires to the Millionaires Club is not the right answer.
Right on.
Right. Right, of course. Matt, we have time for just about one more question, and I know that you are well known for being nonviolence and a peace advocate.
Well, although you have to also know that I love to play hockey badly and coached it for many years, so nonviolent is open to discussion.
I see.
Well, you are from New York. You got to play hockey, upstate New York.
Yes. Well, could you tell us very quickly why it's important for the taxpayers, though?
I'm sorry, what was that?
Okay, why is it important to the taxpayers to elect a candidate who is for nonviolence and a peace advocate?
Well, I'm glad you used the word peace advocate, because the woman that I love very much always tells me that there's no such thing as an anti-war activist. And I often would have called myself that, I think, in the past. And peace advocate is really what I am. I absolutely believe that we need to have elected representation that mirrors the thought process that peaceful solutions to everything are always better, and that they always need to be sought out. And when you have a Congress that, in general, is willing to vote to allow for the use of old munitions wherever we may have sold them most recently, every time we have any kind of pretend issue around the world. Usually the issue is resource and why we're not stealing it all so that multinational corporations can benefit. Why are we continuing to elect people who continue to say that we are in danger and we should be in fear and we need to go and hurt somebody or kill somebody?
Right. Thank you very much for that, Matt. That's about all the time we have. Now we have to cut to our spotlight. Yours truly is on the ballot for the 1st Congressional District. I'm Gail Farrell Parker, candidate for U.S. House in Virginia's District 1. I'm a businesswoman, a retired Air Force veteran, and governmental budget analyst. I'm a mother of three, a grandmother of four. I ask for your vote for three reasons. I want to remove the barrier at the federal level that prevents the building of rail. The current policies say to municipal and state governments, if you build roads, the federal taxpayers will pay 80%. If you build rail, the federal taxpayers will pay 20%. The playing field should be leveled so that our municipal and state governments can solve transportation issues with mass transit. More trains, less traffic. I want to ensure we adhere to the Arms Export Control Act and to the U.S. Constitution so that we have someone to lobby on the sale of arms to foreign governments. The U.S. Constitution stipulates that the U.S. Congress is the approval authority for the sale of arms, not the State Department or the Department of Defense. Arms sales made without the approval of the U.S. Congress are illegal, and therefore we have no one to lobby if we disagree with the sales. And lastly, I ask for your vote because this election is about your tax dollars and our children and our grandchildren's future. The federal debt, now at $17.5 trillion, makes the interest payment on that debt this year the sixth largest expense in the federal budget, just the interest payment. By building rail and stopping the illegal sale of arms, which contribute to wars abroad, we can grow the economy, create new eco jobs, cut dependence on foreign oil, balance the budget, and eventually pay off the federal debt. Rail returns $25 to the community for every dollar invested. Folks, I have faith in building rail and in alternative energy sources like solar, wind, and geothermal. Dedicated passenger rail tracks will greatly improve the quality of life for folks in District 1, and in fact, for the entire Commonwealth. Fairfax County is forecast to grow by 1.6 million people in the next 20 years, and coincidentally by 1.6 million new jobs. New dedicated passenger rail tracks, more trains, more often, will ensure that folks in District 1 will continue to have viable access to those good-paying jobs. Rail will make us safer, help us have cleaner air, cleaner water. We will create new green New Deal jobs, jobs in solar energy, wind jobs, geothermal jobs, rail jobs. Echo for the economy. We can grow the economy and reduce the debt by building rail. That is why I am the best choice in this race. Citizens want new dedicated rail tracks with more trains that run more often, Williamsburg to Charlottesville and Richmond to the National Capital Region. Send me to Washington so you can count on me to get the job done. More trains, less traffic. Vote for Gale for Rail, Glenda Gale Parker on the ballot November 4. Thank you very much, Matt, for being on Green TV today. Mr. Matt Funichello, Green Party candidate for U.S. Congress from the great state of New York. You can learn more about Matt Funichello's campaign at www.mattfunichelloforcongress.org. We look forward to hearing more about Matt's successful campaign in the future. And we want to thank you, our viewers, for tuning in, and Pat LaMarche for being here with us today. We hope to see you again for more independent Green and Green Party candidates. Join us on Green TV again for positive, eco for the economy, Green New Deal solutions. We look forward to hearing from you and your views on Twitter. Tweet us at #VAGreenTV. I'm Gale Farrell Parker. See you again next time.